wealth isn't always financial, because the freedom you have to create is really, that's what drew me into it. And that's what keeps me into it, is that daily discovery. You know, an artistic path is a crooked path. You move around, you do the little this and you do a little that. And it's sometimes you come to something where you go, oh my God, you know, you get to a peak or an insight or something like that. Those are the little crossroads, I think. And so I try to point out where they are.
Hey everyone, this is your host Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 70 of RS Decoded. And before I get into the episode, I just want to express a esoteric sort of thought that I was thinking. And I was thinking to myself, you know, what really constitutes someone to be considered a philosopher? For example, I think philosophically, probably a majority of my time, like a lot during my day, I try to interconnect different philosophies and different ideologies and experiences throughout the day. But, you know, does that make me necessarily a philosopher? And who's to say that one person is a philosopher and another person isn't a philosopher? But then I thought that since we're all just an amalgamation of different thought processes, maybe we're all our own philosophers in life, and that in owning that thought, we then step out of the role of being the apprentice and then into the role of the teacher, or in this case, the philosopher. So it's just a little thought that came to my head, you know, while I was listening to this episode, and I just thought that I would share it with you. But anyways, this is the episode with John F. Simon Jr. He is a multimedia artist and software art pioneer whose work can be found in the permanent collection of the Whitney, the Guggenheim, and the MoMA in New York. He also collaborated with Bjork to write an app for her album Biophilia, which was in 2011. And John, he's such an amazing individual, and I had a really great conversation. And I think in his own right, he is a philosopher of thought himself. And, you know, we talked about different things from artificial intelligence to virtual reality, which is a topic that tends to come up a lot on my show. But yeah, I've really had a really, really great conversation with him. And he's currently promoting his book, Drawing Your Own Path, 33 Practices at the Crossroads of Art and Meditation. If you want to go check it out, you can go and purchase it either on Amazon, or you can purchase it on www.drawingyourownpath.com. You can also check out John's work at www.numeral.com. That's numeral.com. Also, there's no obligation, but if you'd like to donate to the podcast, please do so at our website, artistdecoded.com. You'll be able to find a donate link, which directs you to our PayPal. And if you can't donate, that's totally fine. I understand, so no pressure there. But if you can, it'd be amazing if you can go to iTunes and leave us a review. If you feel like giving us a 5-star, that's totally up to you, hint, hint, but I'll let you make that decision for yourself. So here it is, episode number 70 with multimedia artist and software art pioneer, John F. Simon Jr.
Hello.
Hey, John.
Hey, Yoshino.
Hey, how's it going?
Finally good.
Good to talk to you.
Exactly.
I know we've been trying to set this up for a while.
And, it's good to hear your voice. Sounds just like your podcast.
Yeah, I hope so. Sometimes I'll, you know, when I use filters and I'm just kidding.
All right.
Voice augmentation software. Something like that. Anyways, how's it going? How's your day?
Oh, it's great. Going great. Yeah, looking forward to this. So,
yeah, me too.
Glad it's getting going.
Yeah, Noah and Corey say a lot of really great things about you, and I've listened to both those podcast episodes.
Yeah, we've had a good time. I've known Corey for a while, and I just met Noah, but he's actually visited here now, so he's a cool guy.
I mean, Noah was saying that It was his favorite podcast episode.
We had a good time. He was at a moment when like what I was talking about was helpful, like how to open up his creativity.
So that
worked out very well. I was happy to help him. We still talk. He's putting together a course, so we've been talking about what he's putting in it and how telling him to make it more personal and tell more stories and that kind of thing. So that's been fun. I'm happy to help wherever I can.
Yeah, I could tell that, you know, in his episode with you, you know, you can tell like by the questions that he was asking. Well, and also maybe it's because I know him personally, but you know, about like going through that creative rut and trying to figure out what the next steps are.
Yeah.
I think that's a pretty relatable topic. I mean, the podcast, this podcast in particular, was the inception of a creative rut for me. And yeah, I don't know. It helped me get out of that.
It's funny how sometimes the ruts lead to some of the greatest breakthroughs, right?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's because you just begin to question why you're feeling that way or why you feel like you're in a rut. And then you try to examine it and open it up and examine it from the outside and then figure out a solution.
Yeah, no, it's true. It pushes you back to the, you know, your first principles, to just like the beginnings of why you're doing what you're doing. You kind of get back in touch with that. Mm-hmm. And it's a time for a lot of introspection, which, you know, if you've got things that you haven't dealt with that are lingering down there, it's a time to get them out. That clears the way, you know, and then you can see more clearly. Oh yeah, I always wanted to do this. This is the time.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, you must have been thinking about podcasting. You have the voice for it, so that's cool.
You know who you know is really has the voice for it is Corey.
Yeah, absolutely. That's without question.
He has like a buttery smooth voice.
Oh yeah, no, it's true. Made for radio.
He's specifically made for radio. But thank you. I appreciate that compliment, man. I mean, I guess we can, you know, just go into it. I did want to ask, originally, your formalized education, or when you went to college, it wasn't within the arts until you went to SVA. Is that correct?
Yeah, I did some art at an undergraduate at Brown, but I also did a science degree at the same time, and the art was sort of peripheral. I mean, there was no conception at that time that I could make a living doing it. So it wasn't until I finished a master's in geology, earth science, that I went to SVA, and then it was really with the intention of trying to, you know, make a living at it.
What career path did you think you were going to go down when you first entered college?
Yeah, I thought it was going to solve all the I was going to, you know, unravel the mysteries of the universe and be a physicist. Mm-hmm. I was going to study the galaxies and the, you know, try to figure out what was going on here, which in some ways is what I've always done. I continue to do, but with different methods, I guess. At some point I saw the limits to science, at least for me, and what could be done.
What point was that? Did you realize that?
It took a while. At very first, I looked into physics and I liked it a lot, and I still do. And I still love to read about all the things that happen in, you know, particle accelerators and space telescopes. And I like all that in a fascination. But the day-to-day operations were like doing math problems. And that was okay. But, so I wanted something a little more applied. It seemed like a little too theoretical, and I didn't enjoy all the pure math. So I went into geology, where we were going on field trips and looking at the rocks, and we were still doing some quantitative stuff. But it was like a mixture of being out in the world and doing quantitative stuff, which was nice. And I went up into graduate school with that, and we were looking at images of Jupiter and Saturn through telescopes and breaking down the spectra and analyzing the spectra. So it's early days of digital imaging. That's how I got into digital imaging. But then I started to see that there was, there's a certain methodology, the scientific method, and you make a hypothesis and you make a measurement, and it's all within a context of a certain idea about materials and the universe. And my ideas were broader than that. And there was more of the mystery and and the discovery that I was into. And science is very slow and kind of plodding, which is good.
Yeah.
And it works well for it. But was personality wise, I started getting more and more contradiction. And I like to move. If you look at the history and the trajectory of my creative work, I move through media and I move through ideas really quickly. Yeah. And so I needed to give some liberty to that. And at that time, this was mid-80s, and the Macintosh was making its splash. So all of a sudden, it became possible for art schools to have computers. And here I had this background from the sciences and how to operate them. So I went right in. I was in the first, you know, couple of classes at School of Visual Arts that did graduate computer art, they called it then.
What was that first rendition of artworks that you made? And run me through your mindset of when you wanted to switch from, you know, doing something more scientific to something that's more based within the arts.
Well, we were looking at photographs. First, I looked at photographs of Mars, which was one of the first digital cameras to be sent out in space. And that was the first time I saw pixels, and I realized I could write programs to manipulate the pixels. So the possibilities of just being able to compute anything and see it on a screen was, I mean, it was quite something. And I'd done a lot of photography up to then. That was my art, was photography. And I considered myself a photographer. It was more kind of a hobby. And I could see how photography and computers, which up to then had been all sort of mag tapes and bits and bytes. And then there was the Macintosh, which was very graphic. Yeah. I could see how photography and computers were going to mix. And of course, now it seems silly because we walk around with huge, great 4K video cameras on our phones.
Yeah.
But which blows your mind. But you couldn't have imagined that in those days. It seems like so old, but it's not even that long ago.
How time flies like that.
It's hard to convey what it was like not that long ago, right? And how technology has just moved into every aspect. I mean, there was a time when people would say in a kind of proud way to me, "Oh, I'm computer illiterate," you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Think, what, you don't know how to use a phone? But people were resistant to it. They would ask me when I went to School of Visual Arts, because they had started in a kind of a visionary way, a master's program in computer art. What do computers have to do with art? Now it seems silly, like PageMaker,
yeah,
you know, Illustrator.
Yeah, it seems like a lot
Photoshop.
A lot of art can be made through the computer.
Yeah, it wasn't even obvious then. But I saw it. But that was the glimpse. That was the thing you're asking, is that I caught that glimpse that was gonna. I could see enough of having worked with these kind of primitive PDP-11s and early deck computers and doing the image processing and bringing it up. If you wanted to do a contrast stretch, you know, you just want to change the contrast of an image, you'd have to write a little program and adjust the bars, and it'd be like 7-8 minutes of computing, and then it would come up. But now you just drag the little sliders around. But I could see even from that, this is really the vastness of the possibility of what's going to happen to imaging, knowing what I did, having walked around with a camera and try to make photographs, what was going to happen, and do and be in the dark room and manipulate in the dark room and put them through chemistry baths. And I said, this is going to be something. So I went as soon as I saw that opening. I could really apply some of this technical knowledge that I have to creative work. And that seemed to be home for me. And it has been for all that time. That was that sort of mixture of some analytical side thinking and some creative side thinking, and moving it back and forth is really, that's what drew me there. And that's what kind of I've worked since then.
Okay, so what was that first project like? I'm just taking it back a bit, just to put a little, you know, for the viewer. Or, I mean,
sure, no, that's fine.
Context. you know, because a lot of people want to move out of like a 9-to-5 or
right. Oh yeah, okay.
Some sort of, you know, an exploration of their creative mind.
And right.
How did you find that?
It for me was great, but it's to go from one graduate school to another is one thing, and then to go from the graduate school to teaching is another, and then to go from the teaching just to be an artist sort of 24/7, that was the biggest leap, and that was the most scary, and to try to find a way to support it. And there were many years, you know, and intermittently still years where there's not a lot of money coming in, so you have to take risks and move around. But the wealth isn't always financial, because the freedom you have to create is really, that's what drew me into it. And that's what keeps me into it, is that daily discovery. Yeah. So in the beginning, I did the graduate work, and then I taught, which is not uncommon for artists. About that time, it was early 90s, the World Wide Web happened. That hadn't happened up to then.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember Windows 95 came out.
Yeah, it was, there was a browser, you know, this browser happened. Well, I was in the middle of New York City, which is filled with ad agencies and offices and all kinds of businesses that needed immediately web pages and websites, because it was a brand new thing. So there was a freelance business that sort of bloomed. And I always say to people who are struggling with how they're going to apply their creativity, what if you were a web designer and it was the late 80s? You wouldn't know yet what your calling was, because it hadn't been introduced yet. So there may be a technology coming that really suits you. So hone your skills and keep your work going, because there's something there. So there it was. It was a business for many years, supporting sites, writing code on the back end of websites, and working with artists to build their websites. And so I got to meet a lot of people, and I got to know a lot of people in the art world that way. And that's, you know, networking is a big deal. And it's different now, because in those days you really had to be in New York, and the gallery scene was really in New York. And now people are selling artwork over Instagram, and the art fairs are a much bigger part of the art scene. Mm-hmm. And people can communicate more instantly. So it's a little different now, but I don't think the principles of networking are any different. You meet people and you find kindred spirits, and you find people whose aesthetic matches up with yours. You get followers, and so there's no secrets to that part of the business. It's pretty clear. You do a lot of legwork.
The thing that's changed, I think, with social media is that unless you actually know that person, you just kind of see a facade of what they're trying to project out into the world.
It's true. That's what's so cool about you doing that on site and that project in LA, when you brought people together. Was it last week?
Oh yeah. Yeah. So yeah, I'm trying to do more of those, because we have a space, me and two business partners, another artist, Justin Hopkins, and my other business partner, Mark Manguera, developed a multimedia creative agency, and we have a space over in Little Tokyo in LA. And so we're doing these events, some pretty big events, like once or twice a month. But a lot of it, you know, the reason for these is to be able to bring community together. And to have some of these, I mean, especially for that Mindwave event, is to have these conversations about, you know, where art and spirituality meld together and mindfulness, and you know, and how that can be applied.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's good. And we do in the Drawing Your Own Path community, we meet once a week online through a Zoom chat room and draw together. We all draw together. And it's not exactly face-to-face, but it's a similar idea, is that beyond posting pictures and such, that there are people behind it and their community behind it. And that's what you want to find. That's what will build up.
Yeah, because I think with art especially, I mean, depending on what kind of art you do, but, you know, if you're a painter, you're generally doing it by yourself. So that sense of community can be lost if you don't seek it.
You know, no, true.
Whether that be, you know, seeking it through putting your work out there, like on social media, or, you know, seeking it in the physical realm, you know, in the real world, it could be lonely, I think.
Yeah, no, absolutely. No, and there you can be in the middle of New York City and be a lonely painter if you don't go out. But on the other hand, you can be in the middle of the Midwest and be connected to painters all over the world these days. And that's also sort of amazing.
Yeah, it's crazy how technology's progressed even in the past like 10 to 15 years, or even the past 5 years.
It's relentless. It's amazing. It's relentless. It's changed. It's, you point to it, it's changed it. That's, I mean, you're looking at a singularity, I think. You're looking at if you took a history of communications up to now, human communications, you would see a spike in terms of the number of connections and the way people are connected and the amount of information that's connected. And of course, if you look at it on that scale from 1960 to 2020, what's that, 60 years on a time scale of, you know, 2,000 or 3,000 years is one little dot. Yeah. And yet it would be this enormous spike.
Yes.
Yeah. And we're living through that. We are. We're seeing that change as it happens.
I wonder, so I'm really curious, and I like the idea of this at this point. I don't know if the technology is quite there yet, but the idea of virtual reality is really appealing. And to understand or just to see the progression of that and see where it's going to go, I think is really interesting. What are your thoughts about that?
I've seen it for so long, and I've seen the promise for so long, and I think the promise is still really good. I think the execution is getting better. One thing I like is persistent spaces. I like the idea that we could share space, that we could have a clubhouse or a yeah. or a studio building that would be in virtual reality or some sort of augmented reality. Also, I think is really great. So you're seeing these things overlay on the things that are around you. Mm-hmm. And I could go into your studio if you're not there. I could leave you a message. I could see your work. You know, we could, if our avatars happened to meet, we'd have a conversation. They'd be common spaces. I think the promise is amazing. And there are examples from way back. They had the multi-user Moos, and then Second Life and these sorts of things have come along.
Second Life is actually coming out with, at least from what I've heard, is that they're developing virtual reality software that is going to be like Second Life in virtual reality.
Right. Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah. Do you remember a book called Snowcrash by Neal Stephenson?
Mm-mm. No, I haven't
read that book. That's a really good way that it lays out the getting the online life, the virtual life, and the real life, and he mixes the two very well. And when you plug in, a person lives in a shipping container, you know, in a very simple, like almost monk-like existence, and a very simple physical existence. But when he plugs into the net, he's got a whole elaborate mansion, and you know, much more. All sort of on the online currency and the offline currency. Some of the stuff has come true. In the book, one of the characters wants a very particular kind of motorcycle, you know, with very particular features and a color, and you know, and constructs the whole order online. And then he shows up at a dealership in the physical world the next day, and he says, "I want this, 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 and this." And the guy's like, "We have nothing like that. It would take months to order." And they look around, and the truck is driving up with the thing because he's got it all ordered and shipped and all figured out ahead of time. And that sort of happens now. I mean, you customize products, and they come to your door.
Yeah,
and it's kind of think about that versus we used to just get in a car and go to a store, and whatever they had, we bought.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of conversations that could probably be had around that, but. In terms of customization, I mean, you know, it's all different technologies, right? So, you know, even with virtual reality, if you're able to go in to a system and then, you know, be able to customize like a vehicle, like you're saying, I mean, I don't think we're too far from that.
I think the vision is there. I think the way it'll come into our lives. Yeah. I'm just sort of recognize how it'll actually incorporate. So in some ways we're living in VR, in some ways we have this idea that we'll be completely immersed, which I think, you know, they did what did they call it, the panopticon? They did these big panoramic scenes in France in the 1800s. You know, they'd paint a set that would look like a street scene, and they'd even bring live animals and actors in.
Yeah.
And people would sit in the theaters before film, before motion pictures, and they'd sit there and they'd shine a light. It was like the sun rising, and they'd act the whole thing out. And it was an immersive experience. And I think that tendency, that desire is still trying to manifest itself here, you know, 150 years later.
Yeah. It's interesting the different capabilities that we have access to now that technology is so advanced.
Yeah.
I was reading somewhere, and I think it was on one of your bios or maybe on your website, you're talking about artificial intelligence and that you...
Oh, yeah.
Had a period of time where you're studying artificial intelligence. Is that correct?
Yeah, I was trying early 2000s when my computer art appliances were popular and selling, and I was writing a lot of code. I was trying to write an AI that would be creative, that would be instead of solving traffic problems or something like that. It would be an artist, but it would be an AI, and I studied all sorts of conventional algorithmic techniques, genetic algorithms and emergent behaviors and self-organizing systems, and implemented in some of my artworks those systems and let them run and tried to watch them and understand how to turn those into this autonomous creative system. Mm-hmm. And I found a lot of limits with that. I mean, I found what it could do, and I've seen in the time since then a lot more amazing things that line of thinking can do. But well, I found some limits to it, like I say, and I think one of the limits was that the system will always reflect its creator, that it's really hard to get out of the way of your own code because you're making all the decisions about what is a good image or what the kind of image is the right answer for the system to create.
Yeah.
So it comes up with something and you don't like it. That's still you in there not liking it and choosing it. That I found that a lot in genetic algorithms. There's a thing called the fitness function, which judges all the results of the one generation breeding in the genetic algorithm. And chooses, you know, the most fit ones. Well, whoever writes the function for what's most fit is the one that's really making the aesthetic decisions for that system. So there was I was trying to still get out of the way of that. And that's really what led me to meditation. That's what got me going, because when I found the limits to the technical side of it, I thought, well, I feel like I'm doing that. I feel like I know what that is. So what is it in me that's deciding that? And so I started to spend a lot of time in the studio making improvisational drawings and just watching myself and trying to decide who it was that was doing that creative work. And so I never found that the answer for that in terms of something that I could write into code. But of course, spending that much time in introspection, all the benefits of meditation started to accrue until it finally just kind of totally opened up.
I guess that's a good segue to talk about your book. When did you decide that you wanted to create this book, and why did you create your book?
Yeah, it's good. Good question. Well, it sort of came on to me, sort of found me. I had been doing that introspective improvisational drawing for maybe 6 or 7 years with the intention of trying to decode it into an artificial intelligence when I had one experience, which is called a no-self experience. I found out now, and I didn't know what it was then. Mm-hmm. But when you go back to this, when I went back to the source of creativity, I thought I was going to find a little engine that I could duplicate. But in fact, what I found was when I went back to my own creative roots, that it didn't come to one point. It expanded out into like my whole life, like every little thing of my life, how I grew up, my whole history, how I like to live, the things I ate, all those things were contributing when I got in the studio to what came out. You know, if I was too warm, the lines were one way. If I was in a hurry, the lines looked different. You know, if I thought I was trying to make great art, it looked one way. If I was just fooling around, it looked another. So I realized that creativity was coming from sort of all through my life. And there was really no one decider back there making those decisions. So you know, I kind of freaked out.
yeah, you had an emotional breakthrough / breakdown.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, what is happening to me?
That's awesome.
Because there's nothing back in there, you know, it's all just this flowing system. And I was drawing these drawings I called cycle drawings, and at one point the center of the cycle drawings became these profiles, and that's what cued me in, that the self is a construction of everything that surrounds it. And I thought at that time, I've made this incredible discovery in the history of spirituality. But then I started to read and check into the histories, and I found that this is actually, you know, a marker on the path. This is actually something. And then I started to think, how could it be that by just drawing and just doing introspection, I could come to this? So I started checking out lots of traditions, and I ran across the Buddhist Geeks, which was at that time run by Vincent Horn and Emily Horn. And he was making a number of podcasts with the Buddhist teachers, and they were offering what they called life retreats, which were retreats you did in your own studio and then worked with a teacher online, which suited me perfectly. And that suits the whole technology. What's happening and changing today is that you can contact a teacher through Skype. And that's what we started doing and talking about it. And they were at that time following in the Mahasi Sayadaw Theravada Buddhist tradition, using noting and other practices. And they use there something that's called the Progress of Insight Path. It's a sort of a map to awakening, and we found where these things were happening on the map. Some not in the linear order of the map, but I was sort of crossing around and having these experiences. And so working with them for a while, a couple of years, and sort of getting the alignment of my creative process and a kind of meditative process figured out, Vincent had a conference. I guess it was the third or fourth time they'd had a Buddhist Geeks conference, but they asked me to come out and talk about how my drawing process equated to a meditation. And at that conference, I met the publisher from Parallax Press. I met someone there who was there selling books from Parallax Press, who came to one of my workshops, and she got a lot out of the workshop. And then, long story short, about 5-6 months later, I had a contract to write the book. But I was into, I've been working like by at that time 15 or 16 years on the drawings.
Yeah.
So it just, I wrote the book in about 4 months or something like that. It came out pretty quickly. And I had all the illustrations because I have, I don't know what, 5,000 or 6,000 daily drawings on cards.
Yeah.
Sitting around. The book was just a kind of a summary of that whole practice. And it's called Drawing Your Own Path, 33 Practices at the Crossroads of Art and Meditation. And that crossroads is how an artistic path is a crooked path. You move around, you do the little this and you do a little that. And it's sometimes you come to something where you go, oh my God, you get to a peak or an insight or something like that. Those are the little crossroads, I think. And so I try to point out where they are.
And, I think, listening to, the reasonings why you created the book and how it led you down that path, these kind of natural occurrences, whether they're logical or illogical or by chance or what have you, it takes time. It takes a lot of time to figure out who you are and what you're about, and to figure out, the path that you need to take. And I'm saying the path that you need to take because, I think a lot of us kind of, especially when you're younger, maybe like right out of college or in your early 20s, or maybe even all of your 20s, I don't know. I mean, mm-hmm. It doesn't necessarily have to be about age, but it takes a long time to make your path, is what I'm trying to get at.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
And I think it takes a lot of patience to find that, and a lot of self-reflection. And I have this theory about happiness, and that to really be happy, you have to be completely honest with yourself in every single aspect of your life, whether that be with relationships or friendships or, what you do for work or hobbies or whatever,
So really, true.
Yeah, to really examine that and to really understand, why am I doing this? Why am I friends with this person? Just being honest with yourself, It's not like you go around every single day questioning your reality, but...
No, I agree. I think being honest with yourself, also part of that is to... be able to be okay with whatever's coming up, and to be able to recognize when, there's a tightness, or when you're sort of getting upset or what have you. And to be, like you say, be honest about what it is that's causing that, to be able to see, I'm not happy because I see that I'm clinging to my desire to keep this thing for myself, or I'm upset because I didn't speak to someone. That's an honesty to yourself to really recognize what those emotions are and to be able to let them go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
So there's a lot to be said there. Yeah, being honest about what it is you like and what you want to make and what your abilities are is also a really humbling and interesting thing, because I'm not by birth a naturally talented artist in terms of rendering things, even though I love to render, and even though most people's idea initially of what, when you say drawing, is drawing a picture of something. Mm-hmm. And so, first of all, to come to terms with how much I wanted to practice and hone my skills and be able to learn to render, and how important that was to me, but also saying, if I let myself go and I just create and I'm honest about liking what I create, can I accept that? That's who I am. It reveals a lot about who you are. That's what I love about the drawing your own path, is that you reveal to yourself, really, if you're able to let go and let yourself improvise, who it is you are, what your tendencies are, really.
Yeah.
Because if I let a room full of people draw, and I do workshops and they all draw, everyone draws something different. If I say, everybody just draw what you feel like, they all draw something different. They're all revealing to themselves at that moment who they are. You know, like I like a certain color. I like a certain form. If it's not like the happens to be trendy right now or in fashion right now, am I honest that I still really like that? Am I willing to stick with that and make that, you know, as any stylistic decision has to be, you know, it has to come from deep inside. It has to come from like that great joyous energy that comes up. And the more you can get in touch with that, that love of drawing, that love of what you're doing, and let that move through, then the work is going to be, you know, what you want to see. Yeah. It's going to come out that way. So, I try to do exercises in the book to get people to let that loose first off, and to quiet the inner critic, which is another big issue with drawing or any creative act.
Oh, for sure.
Using the mindfulness as a tool. I mean, there are a lot of aspects of mindfulness in the book, but one is using that mindfulness as a tool just to recognize, as I say, when that tightness comes up, whether you like or dislike something, and being honest about what that is. And when you make a mark, when I have people make marks on a piece of paper, there's going to be an evaluation. That's just it's just kind of almost an instinct. It's kind of a natural reaction to think whether you like it or not. And I'm not saying whether you do like it or don't, or whether it's good or bad, but just having people you step that little distance along the meditative axis and just see that come up. Just say,
I realize it.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. Just realize it. That's really the first exercise. Just realize that there's going to be all this shit that it's going to hit the fan as you work, and just see it. Don't even think about what it's doing or what it's saying or what you're making is good or bad. Just seeing that come up, and then just practicing watching that come up, you know, and then pretty soon it kind of doesn't dominate the whole field of view at first, you know, like it does at first. Then you start to make, and then you say, okay, I see that that's happening, but I can move through and continue to make, and I can continue to work. And you just get closer and closer to flow that way. You just get closer to just being in awareness as you work.
What would you consider, because I have my own theory of what I think meditation is, but what would you consider meditation to be?
Well, it's pretty vast, and there are a lot of sort of applied and pure areas of it. But I think there's a book called Secret of the Golden Flower. And they have a terminology in there called turning the light around. So it's like if attention is that light. I just think meditation for me in the very most basic sense is just being able to turn that attention, that light around, and introspect. Just see what's happening in the mind. Now, when you first turn it, of course, it's like a zoo or something, you know. Like you try to sit down and meditate.
And the headlights or something.
You turn the light around, and it's like, yeah, and it's nervous. But then all those things you realize are just coming up. They're just thoughts or emotions just like moving through. And as you sit, as you meditate, that's you slow down by either focusing on your breath or what have you, drawing, watching the pencil. And recognizing those things as they come up. So yeah, for me, meditation in a very general way is just being able to watch the mind.
Yeah. For me, meditation is about being, I agree with what you're saying. I think it's about being fully focused on something.
Mm-hmm.
And, that's why I've been equating, working out as a meditation.
Right.
Boxing. Because
I
box and I have to be fully like
present. There's good evidence that shows if we engage two or more of our senses, that default network of chatter in the mind will quiet down.
Yeah.
And so if you're boxing, yeah, you're engaged physically and probably very heavily visually, so you don't get hit.
Yeah,
when you're drawing, you have a physical connection to the pencil and paper. There's a sound element, there's a visual element. And so if we put our attention, we move that attention to those sort of sensory experiences, yeah, the mind will quiet. And then again, you're closer to flow. You're closer into that sitting in awareness.
Yeah, it's crazy how powerful the mind is. I mean, even last night, for some reason, I mean, I knew I was tired because I spent the whole day working. But I couldn't go to sleep. And it's, you know, I think it's just because I was thinking so much about different things.
Sure.
But I don't know. I just feel it's crazy how powerful your mind can be And it's sometimes it's hard to turn that off. It's hard to turn those thoughts off. Oh, absolutely. You know?
Yeah, I tell people to go when the mind's too active, go into the body. You know, use the other senses. Focus down on the senses. So for me, I find when I can't sleep, oftentimes if I remember to look at my hand, I'll realize my hand is like almost in a fist, like my fingers are curled.
Yeah.
And if I just take the time to relax, really physically relax those and focus on the relaxation of that, I'll be gone. So that's, I mean, just to, there are a lot of techniques to put it out, take it and put it out of the, but I mean, that what happens, what can possibly happen that doesn't happen in the mind? If you think about it, yeah. It's like, it's almost like solipsism. It's your senses are all registered in your mind. Your emotions all come through, all your thoughts. So yeah, it's totally powerful. That's where it's all happening.
Yeah. Yeah. For me, even talking about boxing again, you know, there's a certain resiliency that you teach yourself through the act of boxing or doing something that you have to push your mind and your, to understand how resilient you are as a human being to certain things.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, you know, the way that I look at a lot of things in general is, you know, the way that you set things up for yourself, it's all a system that is in a synergistic system. So the things that you do within your life, it can be parlayed into other aspects of your life. So everything that you do is a lesson, you know, for those other things. Does that make sense?
No, that makes total sense. And I think that you often make choices that unconsciously you're trying to set that up for yourself. You may not even know that that's what you're doing. For better or worse. I mean, I was making these small drawings, like I say, thinking I was doing scientific research in a certain way or computer science research. But really, when I got the benefits of them, that's what I wanted. So, yeah. So I had to rationally justify my actions on one side of my mind so that I could enjoy the benefits of it on the other, for instance.
Yeah.
So, I agree. I think we're guiding ourselves. And this being a little more awake and aware of that guidance, yeah, I think it can bring things into greater sync even.
How did you tune in to that love and that honesty and that curiosity to be able to, because you were saying about, you know, if you follow your career path that you go and you learn about, you know, different things and then you execute, right?
Right.
So how did you hone into that? Because I think a lot of people are trying to find that.
Yeah. Like, well, there were some pretty dramatic incidents and a lot of fear, but also getting finding the benefits of it as it went. So it can be, if people are interested, they can start with small practices. And I just started drawing every day and it wasn't the main thing that I did. And then 10 years later, it was the main thing that I did. It sort of didn't happen overnight. Intuition is a really interesting thing. And for a while I studied just the nature of intuition and what it really was. And, you find out that there is a part of your mind that doesn't have words. And there's some very good research about the visual nonverbal parts of the brain. If you follow Carl Jung and that thinking about the parts of the mind being autonomous intellectual entities, the nonverbal parts of your mind are as smart as the verbal parts, even though the verbal parts might be able to talk about the nonverbal parts. The nonverbal parts are still doing as clever thinking as any part of the brain, but how do they get the message out? And if you don't have a creative practice, if you don't have a way to express yourself nonverbally, how does it get out? It can build up until that. In my early teen years, besides all of the regular teen angst and anger, were
the natural.
Yeah. Up into way into my 20s, because I was working and I was teaching and I wasn't practicing every day at creative work, they were really hampered by not having a creative outlet. So I'm with my kids and with the people I know who are expressing frustration and expressing unhappiness, I'll immediately find out where that creative outlet is, mm-hmm. because that's a way that that nonverbal part of the brain can have expression. Yeah. And they're great examples of people being given a pencil and asked question and just drawing freely, and the answer to the question coming up in the scribbles, you know, or being interpreted from the scribbles, because that aspect of the mind is being given a way to talk. So when you box, perhaps, there's something getting acted out. I mean, I don't know for everybody how it works. I know for musicians, I've seen it work. And of course, for visual artists, I've seen it work. But it can be worked out in cooking. It can be worked out in probably in running and golf and any of those things. And probably the reason you're choosing it is because there's some excess of energy that's going to work itself out that way.
Yeah.
And that's where I find mindfulness is so interesting, because the verbal and nonverbal parts of the brain can get more in sync, because we can observe the mind as it comes up. So we give a little job to the analytical side, and we give a little free rein to the nonverbal side, and they seem to balance better at that point.
Yeah, I think that nonverbal side that you're speaking of, I personally like to call it the personal narrative.
Mm-hmm.
So something that you constantly are telling yourself in your head, you know, but and maybe it's just like little glimpses of it that you tell yourself, but you don't act out on them.
Yeah, I think if you're telling them, I think maybe it's verbal, but sometimes you have an impulse, like you have a feeling, I should be here. You know, I should go to this show. I should try this. Mm-hmm. So there's no word for it, but maybe it's a gut feeling, or maybe it's, I don't know what, a love for it. That those are the real nonverbal cues. And that's really intuition acting. And it's coming, I think, from the intellect of the nonverbal, is trying to signal you somehow through your body, or through some impulse, or through an emotion to steer you in a certain way, because it doesn't have the word, then the voice to say it. But sometimes you can give voice to it. So I find this, I do the drawing process, and I even draw with my left hand now instead of my right. And I draw. Because there's some evidence to show that the verbal part of the brain is hooked to the dominant hand. And my left is my non-dominant, so the nonverbal. I don't know if it's true or not, but I do know that when I first drew with my left hand instead of my right, I looked like a completely different person drawing. So I thought this is kind of interesting.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy how things can change. But if you're, I think that's interesting to just the act of challenging yourself to do that.
And so after I did those drawings, then and anyway, in the book I cover, but there's a section called reading the drawings, and then you take whatever you scribbled out, no matter what it is, no matter if it's good art, bad art, none of that counts. You just scribble out. You let your left hand do it. It doesn't matter. And when you see it, then you do like a Rorschach, you know, you make up a story to it. And that's how the verbal and the nonverbal talk, because the split lane brain research shows that once the verbal side gets a clue about it, then it can elaborate. Then you say, I see. That's what I was thinking about. That's the thing that was suppressed. And I found it to work in the short term and the long term, that symbols come up in the drawing. But it could be, it made me curious about the boxing, to think about how the physical movement and the challenge you're talking about what's expressing, what's being expressed in that motion and in that activity. You have a business and you have business partners and you're working hard. Maybe there's something in there about the,
For me, I know it's always been, I guess I've had this primal urge and this curiosity ever since I was a kid. I really liked martial arts and I've always been attracted to the idea of fighting. And I say the idea of fighting because as a kid, I was an aggressive kid. I wasn't that kind of kid that would go in and get in fights with people.
Right.
In fact, I've never been in like a street fight, because I'm just not that kind of person, you know.
There's a large aesthetic component to martial arts as well, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's trying to mix the physicality of what you're doing as like on the athletic side, And then also the mental side of, for me, it's resiliency and to be able to parlay that into other aspects of my life. Like, it just kind of, you're constantly drilling it into your mind that you can do anything. You know,
yeah.
It's like you can, any fear that you have, you can physically overcome, mentally overcome. And it just, it carries on to the next thing.
Yeah, that sounds really healthy.
Yeah.
Bruce Lee wrote a book. I don't know. It's called The Art of Life, I think is the name. Mm-hmm. But he was very, very into what you're saying.
Yeah.
Which is how the discipline and the practice of the moving the physical body and controlling it translates into the way you conduct yourself in many aspects of your life.
Yeah, exactly. I think, you know, I have certain gripes with the way fighting is commercially portrayed, you know, with boxing, and it's more not just boxing, but like mixed martial arts, like with you know, like the UFC.
Sure.
You know, it's more portrayed like around the drama of it.
Right. But right.
I think there is this very spiritual approach that, you know, Bruce Lee explored with his martial arts and his practice of martial arts that isn't talked about as much, and maybe because
sure.
it's not in the mainstream, you know, it's not something that could be glamorized.
No, it's true. I have the same frustration with the art market, which glamorizes sales and celebrity more than the creative aspects and what's being expressed.
Yeah. What do you think about that? I mean, what is when you say that, like, what is going on in your head about that in the art market?
Well, I was in it for a long time. I'm still in the art market, but say you go to Sotheby's then look at the pre-auction show. It's, you know, it's a sales floor.
Yeah.
And I have real love now, and even more now because I'm working with just anyone who comes on to our Facebook group or whatever, people who are not professional artists, but just to try to, it's really about creativity for me now.
Yeah.
And so what I loved is that expression of creativity in its like most beautiful forms. That's what I really love about art. Mm-hmm. And so to see it all commoditized is, I don't know what, it sort of guts me.
Yeah, but it probably transformed the way that you looked at art and looked at your own personal art too, right? When you were, I don't know, maybe.
Yeah, well, at one point I was all set to, you know, and I did sell a lot of work, and I sold to museums, and I made products that were for sale. So yeah, it did. It transformed my thinking, and there's a place for it. I'm not saying get rid of any of it. I'm just saying that's there's many aspects to how the martial arts are practiced and commodified, and there are many aspects to how art is practiced and commodified. I think I'm seeing a parallel to what you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah. I like to see those parallels too, because then I feel like it makes me understand the intentionality behind why things exist, you know, or why certain systems exist within our world.
Sure. And the choices we have about the place we take in them and how we practice them, I think, and also gives us a little insight about who we're looking for to work with or to discover.
Yeah, exactly. I had another thought. It just escaped me. Sometimes it just happens. I'll just cut them out.
No,
you
I
know?
Get it. That's typical because I work in a very broad thought base. So, and that happens to me. I thought
me
it was
too.
My age or something, but no, I think it happens. It used to happen all the time.
Oh no, it happens to me all the time because I try to like in my head I try to draw different comparisons or like different parallels and figure out how things interconnect and intertwine. I think that's
I was just going to say you're conducting an interview at the same time you're trying to think up, you know, and consider what I'm saying. You're trying to think up what else you need to say. That's tough.
That's true too. Yeah, that's true. Do you, I'm just out of curiosity, do you like strategy games at all? Like strategy board games or anything like that? Have you
sometimes, you know, I play this hole? I play Clash Royale now. Okay.
Yeah,
do you
know
that game?
It's a the Clash of Clans.
It's like a one-on-one Clash of Clans.
Oh yeah.
I think that's a clever game.
So there's
a lot of like planning and momentum and artistry a little bit in that. It's a funny game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like, you know, I liked all those sorts of things, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. Chess and Stratego and Battleship and all those were popular when I was growing up.
Yeah, I've actually never played Stratego, but I don't know. Recently, I've been getting into these, like the past 3 to 6 months, I've been getting really into these strategy board games, because there was a revitalization of board games that happened, I think, like 15 years ago with the Settlers of Catan coming out.
All right.
And
do you play them in groups?
Yeah. I play them in groups. It's not like some of them are one-on-one, but anyways, I was wondering, because it seems like you would excel at these games. Just talking to you. Yeah.
Yeah. I applied that reasoning at one point to business. That's how I get my business established, and I think they're useful that way. But I like the cooperative games too, the networking games. Yeah.
How did you apply it? Yeah, how did you apply it to business? Because there's something that, I mean, maybe it's because of my age, and it's growing increasingly more relevant for me to set up systems in which, you know, to eventually obtain financial freedom. And I think this is a very important thing to talk about, especially with artists, because a lot of the times, at least this is the way that I viewed money, is that money is kind of like a bad thing almost. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like, as an artist, you know, it's like, oh no, I won't do that. Or like, I won't shoot that for money, because I'm a photographer, by trade and director. So it's like, I kind of, I guess,
right. I don't know, maybe. Right, I see what you're saying. You can have that decision, or you could develop, or you develop a product that's so unique that people are hiring you for that. That was sort of my approach to it, because I had the ability to write computer code. So I made these, what I called art appliances. It took probably 3 or 4 years maybe to get the idea to fly. But I was like you're saying, I was not applied to making something for sale. And I think if you make something for sale, you're already behind the curve a little bit, because what you're looking at and the analysis of the market that you have about what's for sale is already there selling. So the energy for that might have died off by the time you actually make the thing, or it'll look like a duplicate. So it's often the creative work is often really the right way to go to get sort of ahead of that. Mm-hmm. But at some point you, as it was told to me, I acknowledged the market. So I found a product that acknowledged the market. In the beginning, I was making pen plotter drawings, because that was really the best way to get artwork out of the computer and onto paper, was with the pen plotter. But in the art market, when you looked at it and when you did a market analysis of it, what you saw was that infinitely reproducible black and white work on paper was very low in the hierarchy, and singular, unique, you know, highly made objects were very high in the hierarchy, and that's the higher up our objects sold for more and got written about more and got more attention, and the lower ones didn't sell as much and didn't get as much attention. So I needed a product that was higher up in the hierarchy, but without trying to make it for that. So I just kept working with materials and playing with materials, and I found if I took a computer screen apart and put it on the wall, it completely changed the way people saw it. If you see a computer screen on a laptop screen with a bezel around it, you know, folded over a keyboard, it looks completely different than if you strip that out and put it on the wall. And that was the magic of art that I didn't really understand, was that every aspect of the visual aspect of it mattered. And so that was a shift. And once that shift was made, I had a product that addressed the market, because now I had a singular technologically advanced object. And so, boom, they sold, and I saw it that way. So it was kind of working a little bit outside the box, but developing a unique style. So nobody said, can you make a painting of this, or can you make a drawing of that? And then I had to decide whether my integrity allowed me to take that job or not. I just went off in a direction of making something that no one had seen, that I hadn't seen.
Yeah.
I say, it took a while to develop.
Yeah, I think that takes a while to develop, and also takes courage to put yourself out there like that as well.
I loved so much the screen and the programming, and still do, that's, I mean, like I say, wealth is not always measured in dollars. And like being able to spend my day developing this and seeing it come out, and every day was a discovery of how things could change on the screen. Now every day is a discovery of how it can change on paper. But being able to experience that on a day-to-day basis was really where I was getting fed.
Yeah.
And really sort of felt like that for a while. Mm-hmm. And I think if you push through those ideas with that love, yeah, and you have at least some idea in the back of your mind that there's a market there and that you want to bring it. Like, I couldn't just write the code and leave it in the computer and never take it out, but it needs to come out some way and always have a way of trying to get it out some way. So in photography, always thinking about how you're printing the materials and how you're framing them and what the subjects are and what the light is and what the color's doing and going with that love. You will come to a crossroads where the market and you agree. And as I've heard many artists tell me, the market, the people who buy your work will find you if you can get it. You print it and you get it to a gallery, or you get it onto Instagram, or you get it somewhere where people can see it.
Yeah.
And people will start to follow that, and then you'll find out if people want $10 prints or if they want T-shirts or if they want big paintings, you know, mm-hmm. by who's following it and what they're willing to pay for and what you feel like you want to offer. Exactly. So that's that part of that strategy that we're talking about is to be awake and aware and analytical enough of what's going on to be willing to try things, at the same time to indulge as completely and as lovingly as possible that creative urge and just let it run, because it's really that as much you as you can get out of that and as much of what you really love you can really get going and perfect in terms of your technique, that's going to make that work stand out. It's going to really be the fullest expression, and the fullest expression in terms of what you choose materially and in terms of what subject it is and in terms of all the spiritual aspects of it, that you really do honestly love that thing that you made.
I think it's a really interesting and self-reflective process to exist, but also as a creative person and trying to find your way and trying to sell your artwork or trying to find a place for it. I think I've just, you know, being a photographer for 10 years, I've just seen what I want to get out of it and that I want it to be more of like a personal approach than to have to take jobs from, you know, from people that I don't really want to work with, you know? And then, so I think, you know, it's really just about creating a reality in which you're happy with, whether that be, you know, with different mediums of art, you know, like, you know, doing, I think it just, it's really just understanding how the world functions and how you can be yourself and be the happiest you, and then the other stuff will fall into place, if that makes sense, you know?
Yeah, it makes sense. And I think the degree to which you're willing to be open to seeing the world around you and your place in it is reflected in your work. So you're making work of your time, and that's really the strongest work that you see. Mm-hmm. We're making work that has memes and signals and colors that wasn't done pre-computer, for instance. we're not trying to make a 17th century oil painting on our computer, make it look like that, because that doesn't even reflect our time. Mm-hmm. We're making the work we can make, and it's broader. We've been in categories in the 20th century: painting, sculpture, drawing. But now those categories, I mean, this is an artwork, a podcast, you know, a multimedia clip, mm-hmm. You know, two or three screen grabs. I mean, there's no category like that. So it's a really beautiful open time to see what moves you and see what you respond to and see what other people respond to.
Yeah. I think similar to you, I like to go through different mediums, you know, like you were saying, this podcast is a medium. It's just a different way to convey a message to people, right?
Clearly, like your self-expression when you see the list of people that you've interviewed, for instance, you can read that like you'd read a painting, you know, to see who is Yoshino and what are his interests and how does he talk to people and where does he guide conversation, that kind of thing. That's as much a personal expression as having made a piece of music or make a painting.
Yeah, sometimes I think that this is almost a truer form of expression because you can say so much more. I mean, verbally you could say so much more, but than like one of my photographs, because a photograph is just a singular interpretation, you know. But maybe, I mean, it's, I think it's all extensions. I mean, for you, you know, this book is an extension of your creativity and your mind. Everything that you've created in the past, they're all extensions of you.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a mirror of the self is how we talk about it. And that's when you can't make a line that doesn't reflect who you are. Mm-hmm. If you make a line, right? If I ask you to grab a piece of paper or grab something and grab a pencil right now and make the line, okay, we'll come back in a week. It happens to be, oh yeah, this paper was sitting there because it's a flyer for something that was going on that day. And this pencil was there because I met so-and-so. It's all built into that one line. Mm-hmm. So everything that's it. And the way the book kind of ends up is to talk about how everything that happens in your life, because I never found the singular source of creativity. Every moment is a chance, is a creative opportunity, you know?
Yeah.
Every moment is filled with creativity. Like, think about all the stuff that's sitting in the room surrounding you and how it got here. It's all been decisions that have led up to that.
Exactly. Yeah, I think the more conscious that you can be of those decisions, the happier that you can be as a person.
Yeah, and I think the more in tune with your stuff and your decisions and who you are, and having a creative outlet lets you reveal some of that to yourself. I think that's probably the most healthy thing that I could tell people.
Yeah, for sure. Well, cool, John. I guess I'll ask one more question. If you had any advice to give to people out there that are trying to pursue the arts or to pursue a creative discipline, what would that be?
I think we said it well when we said, be honest with yourself and really as deeply honest with yourself as you can, and use a little bit of effort and a little bit of discipline every day to practice, and just do a little bit of creative thing that's honestly what you want to do a little bit every day, and see that grow. I think that whether it grows into a business or whether it just grows into like a deep daily satisfaction with making, it'll serve you very well.
Very cool. If people are interested, where can they view your work?
Okay, so the book, which is I'm in the midst of sort of working with, can be seen at drawingyourownpath.com, which is the site for the book. It's all one word, drawingyourownpath.com. And I have links there to a site called numeral.com, which is my sort of professional gallery-based artwork, mostly in New York. Then I have a site called iClock.com, which is my daily drawing practice. It's been going on eight years or so. If you want to see a new drawing every day, you can find it there. But also, we have a community growing on Facebook, which is Drawing Your Own Path, surprisingly. And we do weekly gatherings to draw together. We have meditation sits in the morning. People put their drawings up. So if you're interested in the community aspect, yeah, Drawing Your Own Path on Facebook and also on Google+, and drawingyourownpath.com for the book, numeral.com for the professional work. However, it's easy to find me, John F. Simon Jr. online. So I appreciate it, Yoshina. Let me say all that.
Yeah,
just
of course,
to get the word out there. And my objective now is just to get people to be comfortable with making things, and hopefully making drawings and making more self-discovery that way.
Yeah, I think you're doing a really good thing, man.
I hope to get to LA someday for one of those events and see your space. And if you get out to New York, let me know and I'll come into the city and we'll hang out. It'll be fun to meet you in person.
Of course. Yeah, I go to New York at least once a year, so I'll let you know.
Yeah, it'll be terrific.
All right, John. Thanks so much for being on the program. I appreciate it.
Okay, Yoshino. Thanks a lot.
All right. Talk to you later.
Okay.